Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Wasn't that a very wonderful worship?
Yes.
Hallelujah. You better put your seatbelts, tighten your seatbelt, because this is what we call our power.
Amen.
Amen. Somebody say power.
Power.
Somebody say power. We have some people in the house who are so loaded. Somebody say, loaded.
Loaded.
They are so loaded. Hallelujah. Somebody say, loaded. Hallelujah. One of those people is on this side, the other person is on this side. And when they're going to come out, if you're on the count on this side, you better encourage them, amen?
Amen.
At the end, we'll see which side is really has the spirit of encouragement. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's welcome Minister Eke.
It's for the young heart as well. So Romans 12, verses 11 through 13 says, "Never let the fire in your heart go out. Keep it alive. Serve the Lord. When you hope, be joyful. When you suffer, be patient. When you pray, be faithful. Share with God's people who are in need. Welcome others into your home." Amen. So there's a couple things that I got from that verse, but first I want to start out with an analogy for basically what I'm going to be sharing with you all. And so in this day and age, or always, I know that women and even now a lot more men are into skincare and hair care and all of that. And so when you see somebody with really clear skin, or like really long, beautiful hair, or like hair that like defies gravity and is so shiny and luminous, what is the first thing that you think? Anybody raise your hand if you have anything that... Go ahead, Nabla. Okay, anybody else? Okay. Okay. I'm sorry?
They're worldly.
Anybody else?
Beautiful. I want that.
Mm-hmm. So those are all along things that I would think, or if I'm trying to meet at a middle ground, what I think a lot of people would think. When you see somebody with hair that you like, or with skin that you like, you think, wow, they're beautiful, wow, they take care of themselves, wow, they, them, you, me, that. You think of the person, that's what they did. You think of them, it's your skin, it's their hair, they did that. When ultimately there's something that they've been doing, there's a product that they've been using, there's a certain something that they've been using in order to obtain that, whether it was certain foods that they were eating, or whether it was specifically, like, I know for myself, there's a certain lotion that I use on my face that's been really, really helping me obtain smoother skin. So ultimately, the thing that I want for us to take from that is that unless it is made known that that person has used a specific something in order to obtain that clear skin, that beautiful hair, nobody will ever know where it comes from. They will only think that it is coming from you, it is coming from them, it is coming from he or she, unless that person goes out and says, hey, this is what I have been using in order to obtain this hair, in order to obtain this clear skin. And likewise, we should evangelize the same thing when it comes to our lives. Likewise, we should say the same thing when people see us glowing, when people see us walking in a certain way, when people like or ask us what we've been doing in order to succeed in our lives. It shouldn't just be us walking around, living our lives day to day. People are admiring us, and we're just only allowing them to see what's on the surface. We should be sharing with them the glory of God in our lives. Amen? Likewise, as you have the passion to share what's working on your hair or what's working on your skin, because we really like it when we get a product that really, really works for us. And in the same way, God, who really, really works for us, we should have that same passion to be able to tell somebody, this is what has been working for me. You need to try it out too, because you want to see other people succeed. You want to see other people grow. Amen?
Amen.
And so, if you have out your notebooks, one of my first point, that leads me to my first point, in which I say, passion is not passive. Amen? I looked up both the word passion and the word passive. And so passion means strong and barely controllable emotion, whereas passive is accepting or allowing what happens or what others do without active response. Amen?
Amen.
And so the passion of God, the fire of God, is not passive. When we have the fire of God within us, when we like what God is doing in our lives, when we like who God is, we will not be passive about what he is doing in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
And so when God does something for you, when you see the word of God working in your life, why would you be passive about it? If you are passive about it, then you are not passionate about God. Amen? Because when we are passionate about something, when you're passionate about your jobs, I'll speak for myself, I'm really, really passionate about music. And so I'm always looking for an opportunity to share one of my playlists or to share a new song that I've heard. I'm always making sure whenever I'm in the car with somebody that I'm putting on songs that I'm really, really passionate about, that I want them to be able to experience and take with them. So the same thing we need to do when it comes to God, if we really tell ourselves that we are passionate, that we are on fire for God, amen? Whenever we're in the car, we need to constantly be bringing him up in conversation, sharing songs that uplift people, sharing songs that put his glory inside of somebody's life, amen? We cannot be passive about the things of God. And that leads me to my second point. Often in this generation that we're in, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, we have a lot of issues and some specific issues that I wrote down that we're facing in this day and age, issues of homosexuality, issues of depression. I know a lot of youth are going through depression because they feel as if they're alone. And that just leads me back to my other point. You see your friend is alone. You know a comforter. Why would you not share that comfort with your friend? If you see somebody is shivering next to you, what are you going to do? You're going to try and make them warm. That's in the physical. How much more in the spiritual? Why are we so blinded to the things of the spirit? Not everything has to be a physical manifestation for us to understand that there is a problem. There are problems in the spirit. Another issue is suicidal thoughts, racism, hate. And there are, this point, there are a lot of us, there's a spirit of cowardice that's moving in this generation, a spirit in which we are afraid to speak out, to speak our minds. When people are doing things around us that we don't like and that do not fall in line with the morals and the values that we have been taught, with the morals and the values that are ingrained in the Word of God, we are afraid to speak out. We are afraid to speak up. We are afraid to bring people to that help. We are afraid to welcome others into our homes. And that's what that verse in Romans 12 was saying. It was saying, share with God's people who are in need. Welcome others into your home. And that leads me to my second point. coming from Psalms 91, verse 1, which says, "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty." If you really say that you are a man or a woman of God, then God is your resting place. You abide under the shadow of the Almighty. There is a lot of spiritual homelessness that is going on. There's a lot of spiritual homelessness, honestly. That's really what it is. There's a lot of people who have a roof over their heads and four walls around them, but their spirits are lost. They are spiritually homeless. And just like we see people on the street and we want to give them a dollar, we want to give them a dime, and we say, "Oh God, help them to find a home, help them to find a shelter." But within ourselves, we are homeless. We're looking at physical manifestations of homelessness, but we are not looking within in the spirits. What if that person has a home in their spirits? They have a home. How much of us were driving in cars, going home safely to our families, but we do not have a spiritual home? We are just as lost as that person who has a physical manifestation of homelessness. Honestly, the saving, the evangelism needs to start from within. We need to start looking within. It starts from within. It is not just physical things that we have to focus on. There are a lot of things that are going on in the spirit. Amen?
Amen.
And so my third point is to just be an example, which I was trying to represent in the analogy of the hair and the skin. When you're glowing, you need to let people know what is causing you to glow. And the only way that you can glow is if you read your word, if you pray, if you talk to God. And it's not just about reading the word and understanding what's going on in the word, but it's also about making sure that we're doing everything that the word has within it, not cutting any corners, not leaving any exceptions. Amen? Matthew 5, verse 16 says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." It doesn't say let them see your works and allow them to glorify you, but it says let them see your works and allow them to glorify your Father. We cannot continue to rob God of his glory. We cannot continue to go along those lines of living a beautiful life, living in a beautiful house, and then when people say, "Oh, your house is beautiful," we say, "Thank you." It has to be to God be the glory. We have to continuously share our testimonies with people. Let our light so shine so that our Father in heaven can be glorified. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you for this opportunity.